Hello, everyone, and welcome back again to Fifth Avenue Church Online. Hope that you are enjoying this little taste of spring that we are getting before the rains return to green everything up, of course. But welcome once again. So glad that you've joined us. Pastor Tim's going to be starting a new message series today with another leading lady, and I'll let him introduce that in just a moment. But I would like to lead us in a word of prayer, but just a real quick word regarding the place that we're at right now with the pandemic and meeting in person. As you know, our church has decided that we are going to decidedly err on the side of caution, and we're going to love each other, and we're going to love our neighbor, and we're going to be careful. But these are the days where we can start having conversation again about meeting in person, and we wanted you to know that leadership is earnestly having those conversations and weighing options regarding that. So please continue to look at the website for all of the latest ways that you can connect with Fifth Avenue Church and the latest resources that have been posted, and specifically be looking for more information in the coming days regarding when we're going to be able to meet together. And boy, do we look forward to that day. So let's have a word of prayer. Jesus, we're thankful that your presence once again is with us. We're thankful that we can gather around your word and we can gather around the person of Jesus today and be encouraged and inspired in our faith and be edified in our faith. We're thankful that even though we can't physically all be together right now, that we can gather together in this digital way and be encouraged. And so we're thankful for our pastors today. We ask for your blessing, and specifically as Tim brings the word today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great day, everybody. And here comes Tim.
Hello, everybody. Great to be with you again here today. We are starting a three-week teaching series out of the book of Ruth. We just finished going through the book of Esther. Now we're going to take a look at the life of another remarkable woman in the Bible, the woman of Ruth, and her mother-in-law Naomi as well. That will lead us up into Palm Sunday. And then after that is, of course, Easter. So it's a great season of time in our church life. Let me read for you out of Ruth chapter 1 today. And I'm entitling this message in Ruth chapter 1, Really Bad Days and an Unlikely Hero. And it'll make sense later. But let me read this chunk of scripture for you. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, which is very phonetically pleasing, okay? His wife's name was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. And Orpah, just a little side note for you, I've told you this before, is the name of a very famous person, and yet this famous person's name, it was supposed to be Orpah, but it was misspelled on her birth certificate, and it's the person we know as Oprah Winfrey, okay? Now, here we go. That's just a little free information for you there. When she heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, Naomi and her daughter-in-laws were prepared to return home from there. She left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-laws, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you, as you have shown to your dead and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud and said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." But Naomi said, "No, return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Return home, my daughters. I'm too old to have another husband, even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to two sons. Would you wait until they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has gone out against me." At this they wept again. And then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her." But Ruth replied, Don't urge me to leave you or turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me. When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. So the two women went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them, and the women explained, "Can this be Naomi?" "Don't call me Naomi," she told them. "Call me Mara, because the Lord Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi? The Lord has afflicted me. The Lord Almighty has brought misfortune." So Naomi returned from Moab, accompanied by Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, arriving in Bethlehem as the barley harvest was beginning. Wow, this is an amazing section of scripture. So I want to look at two things: really bad days and an unlikely hero. We'll start with really bad days. We've all had some bad days. Check out these images that I'm going to put on the screen. The first is an image of a guy that saw a hole in a tree, and he poked his head in the tree to see what was inside of it. And what did he find? Quite obviously a porcupine. That is a bad day. The second image that you're going to see is the image of a really expensive satellite that got tipped over. And the caption of it says, "Hey, you think you've had a bad day? I tipped over this satellite and it's going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars to fix. That's a bad day." And then my favorite, I have no image for this, but I found a post online, and it was a woman describing her buying a new Roomba, which is a robotic vacuum cleaner. At the same time, she bought a puppy. Bad decision, because she turned the Roomba on, and unbeknownst to her, the puppy had left a little deposit in a room in her house, and the Roomba swept over that deposit and then proceeded to spread it all over her house. These are some bad days. I think we would all agree. Well, today, as we looked at the first chapter of the book of Ruth, we are introduced to a woman named Naomi, and she didn't just have a bad day. She had a series of bad days. Let me describe the badness she had to endure. First of all, she lived in the days the judges ruled. You might have not even paid attention to that line, but you should have. It's very significant. This was not a good time period in Jewish history. It was known as a time of wicked leaders, of sexual misconduct, of idolatry, of civil war, and rampant immorality. It's written about in the book of Judges, which actually precedes the book of Ruth in the Old Testament portion of your scriptures. Yeah. Now, the book of Judges starts with a well-loved leader named Joshua dying. So there instantly was a void of good leadership. And then a bloody war broke out in which tens of thousands of people were killed, followed by some of the new leaders cutting off the thumbs and big toes of a vanquished king. Ew! That's how the book of Judges just is starting. And then the book of Judges ends by saying this line: "Everyone did as they saw fit." It was like people were just coming off their hinges and the world had gone mad. That's the time period Naomi's living in. So things are bad right off the get-go here. And then during this time period, Naomi endures a famine, and during the famine, she and her husband decide to pack up their family and move to Moab. Moab was a country that started when the eldest daughter of a dude named Lot seduced him, and they had a child together. And the child that was born out of this incestuous relationship was named Moab. So Moab, the country, were the descendants of Moab, the person. And the king of Moab at one point tried to curse the entire race of the Israelites, only to be rebuked by a talking donkey. And you can read about that too. So the Jews considered the Moabites to be unwanted, pagan, and an accursed group of people. To move there was an odd decision by Naomi and her husband, but it was a decision birthed out of desperation. They were just trying to survive a famine. They didn't want to end up in Moab. That's the last place on earth they wanted to live. And yet there she was, stuck in Moab. And the hits keep coming. When they get to Moab, Naomi's husband dies. And then her sons marry Moabite women. Oh, the shame of that. In her mind, it was like them marrying the enemy. And then her own sons die. That is a parent's worst nightmare and deepest pain. So she returns home, at which point her friends take one look at her and say, could this be Naomi? The trouble she'd endured was so intense. It actually had taken its toll on her physical appearance, making her barely recognizable. Naomi's depression was so bad, she decides to rename herself. Instead of being called Naomi, which means pleasant and sweet, she wanted to be called Mara, which means bitter. The string of bad days had really done a number on this woman. She was no longer herself. But here's why I love this story so much. Despite her string of bad days, goodness was blooming all around her. Let me explain that. First of all, she found true love. At her lowest point, when everybody in her life had either died or abandoned her, Naomi found true love, not in the romantic sense, but in the form of her daughter-in-law, Ruth, who refused to leave her side. In fact, the Hebrew word for clung that's used in verse 14 when it says that Ruth clung to her mother-in-law, Naomi, is the same word that's used to describe a marriage relationship. Yeah, when things were at their worst for Naomi, she's discovered she had the best kind of companion, this faithful, loyal companion that was her daughter-in-law, Ruth, a person that was willing to prance through the poop with her, so to speak. I mean, check out what Ruth said to Naomi. I'll put it on the screen. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people. Your God, my God. That is epic loyalty right there. It even sounds like a wedding vow. As a pastor, I've done a myriad of weddings. I've lost count. I don't even know how many weddings I've officiated at. Most people nowadays choose to write their own wedding vows. That can be really good or really not good, okay? I've heard some great wedding vows that have been written. I've also heard some vows that were so fluffy and cheesy, they sounded like the lyrics to a boy band song. But not Ruth's words. They were completely opposite of that. They had substance. Second reason that goodness is blooming around Naomi. First of all, she found true love. Secondly, shuv begins. Naomi's suffering is not where this story ends. It's actually where her story begins, because the bad days that she endured convinced Naomi to shuv. And shuv is a Hebrew word that means return. She, along with Ruth, returned to her hometown, to Bethlehem. She went home. But this was more than a physical return. Naomi was also returning to her true self. This was the first step she was taking into being Naomi again instead of Mara, to being pleasant and sweet again instead of bitter. The word shuv, we actually have a longer word that's a Hebrew word called teshuva, and it's the word we get our English word repent from, which is a beautiful word. It gets a bad rap, and it shouldn't. It's a beautiful word because sometimes we all find ourselves on a wrong path. We make some decisions. We find ourselves on a life path that's leading us away from intimacy with God and leading us away from being the person that we know we were created to be. And in those moments when we find ourselves on that path, God, whom some refer to as the great insistence, or I love that name for God. So here we are on this path that we know we shouldn't be on. And the great insistence comes to us and prods us to get off of that path, to repent, to change our thinking, to change the direction of our lives, to go home, to return to an intimate relationship with God where we're having new adventures with Him, and to return to living out our true selves. Listen, God knew exactly what He was doing when He created me and you. We aren't a mistake. We aren't an accident. We're not a surprise. We might have been to our parents, but we weren't a surprise to God. And we have purpose because of that. And the world needs us to be ourselves. The world needs me to be me and you to be you, just like it needed Naomi to be Naomi and not Mara. And teshuva is what gets us there. It's what brings us home. So let's get personal here. We all endure some bad days. There's no shame in admitting that. I just told Jay yesterday I had a horrible day, absolutely horrible day. But our bad days are not where our story ends, hallelujah. It's where our stories begin. Because if on your worst days, you will take time to stop and just to breathe and look around you, you'll notice that even on your worst days, good is blooming around you. I love the month of March because at our house, my wife planted crocuses, and they're these flowers that spring up every March, and they're gorgeous little purple flowers. And every time I see them, I just think, yay, I survived another Oregon winter. I made it. I'm going to make it. It's going to be okay. They just bring me such hope when they spring up. Right now, no matter what your life is like, no matter how bad it is, look around you and you'll notice goodness blooming all around you in the form of a faithful friend that's going to stick with you no matter what you go through in your life, or in the form of an invitation from God to repent, to shuv, to return to being the person you know you were created to be, and to return to a relationship with God that's full of intimacy and new adventures. Yeah, just watch. Just watch. Take a look and watch. God will turn your bad days into beautiful new beginnings. He's really skilled at that. Secondly, now let's take a look at an unlikely hero. Ruth chose to go with Naomi to a foreign land and risk being thought of as an unwanted visitor and treated as an unwanted visitor. She was making this journey from the known into the unknown. She was choosing on purpose to take the most difficult path, because that's what heroes do. And Ruth was definitely a hero, an unlikely hero, but a hero nonetheless. And at first, Naomi resists Ruth. She tells her, no, Ruth, don't come with me. You stay in Moab, stay in your homeland, get married again, live happily ever after. It reminds me of those scenes that you see in so many movies. You know the ones I'm talking about, where a group of people are going along and one of them gets injured somehow, but impending danger is about to come upon them. So the injured person always looks to their friends and says, go, get out of here, run, save yourselves, just leave me here. And of course their friends will never have any of that. And so they pick up their friend and carry them to safety. Ruth refuses to let Naomi wallow in her negativity and self-pity. She won't just leave her there and take care of herself. Instead, she rescues Naomi out of that pit of despair. And she does this through one word, optimism. Right now, there is plenty of things going on that could make any of us pessimistic about life. And there are enough people that insist on telling us this is how things are and this is how they're always going to be, which keeps us stuck in pessimism. What we need right now, what the world needs right now, is people not that can show us how things are, but people who can show us how things could be. Yeah, the world needs more optimists, just like Naomi needed Ruth. People who will pull us out of the trap of our own self-pity and pessimism and negativity. I want to put up a small quote. It's small, but it's brilliant. And it just says these three words. Optimism is rebellion. That is so true. Optimism is rebellion. Optimists are the people that rebel against the rampant negativity and pessimism that is all around us in the world today. Now, think back to Ruth. Ruth had her own pain. Okay, she wasn't having this charmed life. She'd lost her father-in-law. She'd lost her own husband. She was separated from a sister. She was living in a foreign land and not being treated well. Yet instead of becoming bitter and negative and throwing a pity party for herself, instead she grabbed Naomi and by her actions basically said, hey, I don't know how this is going to work out, but you and me and your God that I just met, we're doing this. So get up and let's go. Ruth was basically being the Tigger to Naomi's Eeyore. We tend to not pay attention to the optimists that are in our life. We easily dismiss them. We think they're just naive people that are going to vomit sunshine on us, when in reality, they're the heroes that rescue us from the pits of despair and negativity that we so often find ourselves in. They're the ones who help us to believe that change is actually possible, even when our circumstances are telling us the opposite. When I think of an optimist, I always think of one particular character in a movie. His name's Sonny, and he's the star of a movie called The Best Exotic Marigold Hotel. And the line that he says that just will stick with me for the rest of my life, I'll put up on the screen for you. He tells people this: everything will be all right in the end. So if it's not all right, it's not the end. I love that guy. I go back to that quote all the time. So maybe right now you feel like you're currently trapped in a cycle or a pit of negativity and pessimism. If you are, pray and ask God to send you a Ruth, an unlikely hero that's an optimist that'll help you to get out of that pit. That'll help you to see not how things are, that's easy to see, that'll help you to see how things can be. But maybe you're not having a bad day. Maybe you're doing great right now. Good on you. If so, then pray that you will actually be used by God as a Ruth in somebody else's life that definitely needs your optimism right now to rescue them. What a great thing to pray. Let me pray for you, and then I'm going to tell you one more quick thing. Some of us are having a bad day right now, God. Some of us are even having a long series of bad days, and it's taking its toll on us. We're not ourselves. Please, God, right now, cause goodness to bloom in our lives. Bring us faithful friends that will prance through the poop that we're enduring. And bring us the gift of teshuva that puts us back on the right path. May this bad day or even series of bad days be a beginning for us and not an end. And some of us need a Ruth right now, Lord, someone who can pull us out of the pits. And God, if any of us is a Ruth, if we are a hero of optimism right now, show us who we can go to and rescue. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this great story we're getting to look at, and thank you for all you're going to do in our lives through our looking at it. We love you. In your name we pray. Everyone said, amen. I'm going to leave you with a little gift today also. When I'm having some bad days, I have this go-to song. It's the most optimistic song I've ever heard in my life. And it just reminds me, yeah, I'm having a bad day, but this isn't the end. It's the beginning. Goodness is blooming around me. So this is the song San Francisco by the Mowglis. And I hope you won't click off your computer before you listen to it. It'll make your day. Have a great week, everybody. And we'll see you here next week for part 2 out of the Book of Ruth. Blessings.